So Lee, you've come to my house. I've told you I want battery and solar. The first thing you do when you come to a job, what do you look at first?
So we want to have a look at your D&O cupboard.
Okay, so the main cupboard over there.
Yeah, so that's where your mains incoming fuse and electricity meter is. I want to check electrical bonding. So water pipes, gas pipes, oil pipes, bonding for incoming services, which is standard for most electrical work. Then we'll take a look at your existing consumer unit and then where you want the installation itself to take place. And obviously anything in between where the cable is going to be running. So we know what cables we're going to be using, the installation methods.
Okay, so for my job, we've had a look at this cupboard over here. So this is my garage supply unit that's coming from my main thing now. I've done the advantage for you. I've already put some Cat 5 cable here. Is that, if someone's already got a garage supply and having it in the garage, is there possible that the garage supply might not be adequate for when they're having a battery?
Absolutely, yeah. So there's a lot of garage supplies on old houses and new builds that are fed from a single socket. There's no way that would be adequate for installing additional equipment like solar, EV chargers and things like that. So yeah, it's really important to assess where that garage supply comes from.
Okay.
And understand what capacity it can take.
Now, the other things some people have read, seen on forums, people online are worried that because they've got a garage split like this, that their solar, if it was connected to the garage supply and the battery connected to the garage supply, wouldn't feed the house. Is that true?
No. So with any solar install, it will feed anything that's on the other side of the meter. So as long as the garage supply is on the same metered supply as the house, it won't be an issue.
Okay.
Some things that you do have to bear in mind is the length of the cable run and what we call the voltage drop. So on long runs of cable, you lose a little bit of voltage, and it's really important that you don't lose too much voltage and can't feed that solar or excess generation back into your supply.
Okay, so when I called you for getting solar, the one thing you had a bit of an aerial survey. We're going to have a quick look at the roof on this garage. So when Morzak EV looked at this roof, you basically said that it's not big enough on this garage roof for any solar according to your software.
Yeah, that's right. So when you join panels up in series, the voltage, you add the voltages together, but with the roof area that you've got, you'll only get two or three panels on there, depending on which brand and manufacturer you pick. And the voltages are not enough to start up your inverter. So if you, even on the sunniest day, in the sunniest conditions, you're not going to get any generation because the inverter has a minimum voltage to start up and start generating.
Right. And I spoke to a couple of installers, and not every installer actually knew that. So
yeah,
there's a small possibility they could have come around, fit the solar panels on the roof.
Yeah.
And I could have just basically had some pretty decorations on.
That's right, yeah. And you wouldn't have realised until a few days later when you start realising, I've got a nice sunny day today. Why am I not getting any generation? It's winter time, so you might think, well, I'll wait till the summer. So it could be a long time before you actually detect that's an issue.
Okay, so I mean, the next roof is obviously the roof behind us, which is the main house, which I'm going to look at separately with you another time.
Yeah.
But for now, we're just doing a battery only install. There's no complications of doing a battery only install?
No. So it depends which inverter and which battery you're picking, but your hybrid inverter, it can have solar or it can operate without solar. Again, depending on which inverter's being picked for your install, you need to just make sure that it will run without solar, but the Livotek will.
And you're MCS approved for solar and batteries?
Yes.
So yep. Does that mean you can get this MCS approved so I can feed back to the grid if I wanted to and get paid?
That's right. So you can register for the smart export guarantee with your electricity provider. You give them your MCS certificate number and that will pay you then for your electricity going back to the grid.
Wow. So even with a battery only, I could charge off grid or on like something like Octopus Agile and play the grid, importing, exporting based on...
That's right, capacity. Yeah. So you can sell your electricity back to the grid when it's cost effective to do so, and you can import from the grid when it's cheap.
All right, Lee, I'll let you crack on with the install. I'll go make you a brew and I'll see you in a bit.
Thank you.
So Lee, you've had your first problem. What's the first problem?
So the first problem is that because your stone here is quite uneven, for aesthetic reasons, I'm sure, it makes it quite awkward when you the brackets flush on the wall.
Yeah.
There's going to be some bits of stone protruding, which is going to foul on the battery.
Okay.
Stop us putting it on the brackets. So we're going to have to drill and mount the bracket and then shim it so it's standing off.
Okay, where's the battery going to sit?
So the battery is going to sit about here, and the instructions require it to be at least 50 mil off the floor. So we're going to sit about 100 mil up, so
okay.
We've got plenty of clearance.
And is it good practice to keep it off the wall for water and stuff, I presume?
Yes, yeah, always good practice to keep it off the floor, especially that's got no feet on it as well, so you don't want the bottom getting damaged as well, but with it sitting on the floor.
So Lee, you've ended up putting it on the wall, but you didn't use any spacers. Why was this?
So these expansion bolts, they've got a hard stop, so we can get the bolt so with the bracket's the correct distance off the wall, so when we tighten it up then it expands out and locks the bolt in position with adequate space.
Okay, so that's basically fixed the issue that we're going to have.
Yes, yeah.
Brilliant.
So and we just need to copy the same thing above. Then,
above.
So they're standing out at the same distance.
Are we going to put the battery on this now then?
Yeah, I think we should do, yeah, so we can make sure we've got the spacing right for the next parts.
And also that it's spaced off the wall correctly for this.
Yes.
Lee, are you a real electrician? Because you own a brush. Lee, we've put the battery on and the inverter on first. Why have we put these on the wall before putting anything else in?
Getting the battery on the wall so we can set the height, then build up the bracket system which fits together nicely, gets all your spacing. Then we put the inverter on. That allows us to make all the connections safely between the battery and the inverter before it's energised. Establish all the connections, make sure we're happy with everything while it's completely dead, and then we can start working our way back to the consumer unit so that we can get it to a point where it can be energised and tested.
Okay, so on this we've got a BMS cable, which is basically a Cat5 cable. We've got two cables going from the inverter to the battery. Now obviously I've not got solar on here. Now we've got two strings for solar. Why is there two?
You get two strings for solar, which is two MPPTs. So these are used to, so a good example would be, say, your house, if you had solar on the front, solar on the back, you would be generating different amounts of power at different times. So by having two MPPTs, it can track those separately. So it can optimize the string to be generating the most, each string to be generating the most at any time.
Okay, so you don't need the little bits that you put between some panels. I can't remember what they're called now.
The optimizers.
So you don't need optimizers.
No, you don't need optimizers in that sort of situation because you can split it between. It's almost like having two separate inverters, except the load, the total power is split between the two strings.
Okay, so what's next now? We've got it on the wall.
We've established all the connections, is install the cabling, just look at the installation method, install the cabling back to the consumer unit, and the same with the data cabling for the CT clamps.
Okay, let's get on to it. So me and Lee have just been talking about some YouTubers who make videos in our industry and other industries that just cram in adverts and sponsorship deals that aren't relevant, which is why precisely we'll be talking about this Velora multimeter, which is obviously topical, and they've obviously sent it me to review, and we will be using this, won't we, Lee?
Yes.
Yeah.
So, yes.
Really decent device, does quite a lot. Very cheap. I'd probably only use it in a collie situation, maybe not if you're an electrical engineer like Lee. But talking about cramming in sponsors, Octopus Energy, not a sponsor of mine, but you can use my Octopus referral link down below to split £100 with me. They do energy dares. topical plug.
The topical referral
and affiliate link,
Nick has loads of referrals already, so if you want to use my referral code instead, check out my video and I'll stick the referral link in the video and in the description.
And it's my edit, so I'll be editing that out. Cheers, Lee. So this connection here, Lee, what is this, the grid connection?
This is the grid connection, yeah. So
is this grid going in?
So this is grid going into the inverter, yes.
Into the inverter. And there's a separate one coming out of the inverter?
Yes, for the EPS side.
So the EPS side will have another one, but feeding the grid is just one connection in?
That's right, yeah.
Okay. And if you had a power cut, it will only power the EPS side?
Yes, that's right, yeah. Okay. So it disconnects the grid side to prevent anybody getting a shock who's working on the lines.
Okay, and if we, in this situation, we're not wiring up the EPS, but if we're wiring up the EPS, would you have a separate consumer unit for the EPS side?
Yes, so I'd have a separate consumer unit. I need to check the regulations of what you need in that consumer unit in terms of RCD protection, and it would need its own TT earth as well. We have a Cat 5 cable fed from the inverter.
Okay.
And we're going to install a meter which will measure the supply, grid supply, and feed that information back to the inverter so it knows how much is being imported or exported if you had solar. I'm just checking the polarity of the incoming plug. So I've disconnected the incoming plug from the inverter, turned on the supply. I'm checking the polarity, and then I'm going to do a ZS just to check that the you've got adequate earth in. So in the event of a fault, somebody cuts through the cable or there's a electrical fault, it will trip the devices downstream in line with the regulations.
So thanks to Lee at Morzak, we've now got this unit installed. Now, Lee, your customers watching this video right now are probably wondering, if they want a battery-only install like this, how much would it cost?
About £6,500.
Okay, and that's because it's got the 20% VAT element?
Yeah.
Okay, but if it was part of a solar install and we were fitting, say, 4 kilowatts of solar to a roof?
4 kilowatts of solar. So, yeah, I think you'd be looking around 9,500, 10,000.
Yeah. And each battery module's about, what, an extra 2,800, £3,000?
That's right, yeah, yeah.
Okay. And if it was a battery-only system, then the install would be probably about 3,500. For an extra battery per module because of 20% VAT complications.
Yeah, again, depending on, also depending on who'd fitted the system initially and what checks you need to do. So if somebody else had installed it, I'd be a bit more, there'd be a bit more work involved to make sure you're happy with the install before adding the additional battery. But that being said, yeah.
All right, well, thanks to Morzak EV for coming out. If you do use Lee over at his channel, obviously you're watching this there, make sure you're making plenty of brews. He does like a coffee, but he has a cut-off of 1 o'clock.
Yeah.
Cheers, Lee.
Cheers, thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So I hope that was useful. If it was, make sure you give us a cheeky thumbs up on that like button, subscribe and hit the bell icon for more videos. Check out our social media. Check out our Octopus EV code, not Nick's. And thanks very much for watching.